Hi.
So we are recording this video just to give everyone a heads up. Welcome everyone. We're so excited to see you all here tonight. And we're so excited to be here with Meghan Picerno, and we're so excited to hear from her and have her work with some singers tonight. I know there are a lot of people very excited about this. So it's great to see some smiling faces out there. Okay, I'm just going to do a quick intro to Meghan. But before we do that, if you are one of our singers tonight, I believe we have four singers, and then if Katie Amen is on here, I think I see her maybe joining. Katie, if you're on here, if you would also message me. So if I can have our four singers and Katie send me a message to let me know that you are here, and also message what you are planning to sing, that would be very helpful. So, and I can give Meghan a little bit of a heads up about this. But we're so excited to have Meghan Picerno here. She is, as probably most of you know, a very talented singer, actress, has been on Broadway and has had amazing experiences singing. And I'm going to tell her, or have her tell you a little bit more about herself so that I don't mess anything up. So Meghan, I will turn the time over to you.
Hey, hi everyone. Thanks so much for joining, taking time, hello, hello, for taking time out of your, well, wherever, whatever time zone you're in to join us this evening. I always love these kinds of masterclasses, particularly this crossover one where I can share my journey and some of my experience coming from the classical world and crossing over into the Broadway world. And actually, I'm about to go back to the opera world again. So it's wild. I belong everywhere and nowhere. I'm a little traveler, which I actually prefer. I like not being in a box. As Mary said, I went to Manhattan School of Music for classical training. This was a minute ago. And then sang some opera. I do actually have opera chops. It's been a hot 6 seconds since I've actually sung full opera, but like I was in Operalia in London and, you know, did all the fun things, was singing in Spain. And that's when my life changed. When I came back here, was cast in New York City Opera as Cunegonda in Hal Prince's final rendition of Candide. And that's when my life completely changed. Broadway took a hold of me, and 6 years later, here I am. So, but in the meantime too, I've just gotten classical representation, and I am planning on doing some version of going back over across the pond into the classical world. So I'm here, specifically this masterclass is going to be to help my fellow classical singers, all the things that I've learned as a classical singer on how to morph into how to use all of that and those tools and colors and make them applicable to the Broadway and music theater repertoire. So, and lastly, I think that is extremely important, especially since the pandemic, but as an American performer particularly, I think if you can do both, you should do both, because both worlds, both music theater and opera, they help each other so much. And it's so fantastic to see what kind of, what kind of crossover tidbits and colors you can use to help each other world. So anyway, I think we should start because I'm always very long with time.
You're good.
So who's our first performer?
Okay, I think Maria is going to be very first. And also, can I just mention to everyone, if you can please mute yourself, yes. Just so that we have the best sound options, that would be very helpful. And you know what, I might just go ahead and mute everyone, and then Meghan, you can unmute yourself. And then Maria, introduce yourself, please.
I think you're muted, Maria.
Yep, I was.
Give me a second to pull up my accompaniment though, so I'm okay. My name is Maria. I'm living in Medford, Massachusetts, just outside the Boston area. So, ciao from New England. And
hello.
I'm going to be singing The Beauty Is from Light in the Piazza.
Oh, I love it. I love it. Okay, let's give it a go.
Okay. It's the land of naked marble boys. Something we don't see a lot in Winston-Salem. That's the land of corduroys. I'm just a someone in an old museum, far away from home as someone can go.
So a couple things. Can you turn your volume up a little bit for me, like for your speaking and anywhere? I can hear you, but if there's any way I can have you turn everything up a little bit more, if not a lot more, that'd be great.
Okay, the accompaniment too?
Mostly you.
Mostly me, okay.
But in the meantime, while you're doing that, so I always like to ask first, even though I have ideas, but is there anything specifically that you would like me to help you with?
I think just, of course, hang on 1 second. I'm going to turn my gain up a little bit.
Oh, that's so much better.
Okay. It was the gain. I use this for recording church and it's always too loud. So sorry. Yeah, but I would really like some help on, again, you know, definitely some acting intentions and some technique, especially on the extremes of my range. I feel like I am getting better at developing kind of that, you know, talky kind of delivery in the middle ranges, but I still think like, oh, she's an opera singer, sneaks in on like the high notes and the low notes alike. So yeah.
I 100% agree with you. And so this is something in general, coming from the classical world that I personally have had to do, which is what we call thin the voice. And it's at first, I mean, it really, I'm gonna be honest with you, at first it really freaked me out because I was like, in the voice, I don't know, like, what does it mean? Like, but it's exactly what you're talking about, which is that speaky talky place. Music theater in general, this is a blanket statement, but in general, it is speech level, American speech level, which is very different than Italian speech level, right? I mean, opera, we pitch things a little bit differently. Also in general, again, in general, the vowels are much rounder and more open in opera as compared to especially American music theater, right? I mean, yes, Adam Gettle, who is the composer of Light in the Piazza, this is a little bit more classical, but it is for sure, it lives in that in-between world, closer to the music theater world, quite frankly. Yeah. And so, again, generalities, vowels are going to be a little bit more spread than you think they are. You're going to sing so much less. I don't mean not as supported, but in general, if I had a dime for every time I would hear, sing less, Meghan, sing less. It's even, do you have the score in front of you? Which, by the way, anyone that doesn't know this song, I know this one well. It is a very difficult song. And bravo to you to picking it apart and really making sure that you have all of those intervals correct. Because that is already, bravo.
I'm in love with this piece. It's one of my favorite things.
It's stunning. And you can tell you love it. Which, by the way, I might not touch on acting as much because the joy that you bring to it is really what it is. I mean, the more specific you can be and the more in the moment, this is the most important thing in music theater, is being present right in the moment, discovering what is happening one right after the other. And actually the singing is like not important. It's the lyrics that are the most important, which as a classical singer always kind of, I was like, I know, oh no, quel dommage, what will I do? But it's true. It's lyric, 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 lyric. Now, let me help you with some of that. Now, also, before I start too, because this is going to go for everyone, breathing is another thing. So in general, when I am singing classically or in opera, when I am taking a breath, it's in such a deeper place. For me, it feels like it's beneath my belly button. And depending on what kind of music theater repertoire you're singing, it feels kind of like everything goes up and up and up, as in if like the most extreme for me would be belting, right? That is full epigastrium, meaning the support is way up here, right? Christine Daae, Clara, like they're a little bit lower because they do kind of touch a little bit, but it's still everything about it. The support is a little bit higher, but it is fully supported. And the larynx, right? In opera, we tend to have like this column. In music theater, it's a different story. It's either like a sandwichy feeling for me, or something else that I feel a lot, particularly in this piece, is an upside down trapezoid. It's like this feeling.
I know what you're talking about.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, I just started learning how to belt, like just now. So like I'm starting to feel that like a tiny bit. Yeah,
exactly. Yeah. And for me, depending on like what repertoire I'm singing, what show I'm in, I will warm up accordingly. So also before you sing this kind of repertoire, keep in mind your normal opera warm-ups, unless you've done them hours before, cool down and then come back, they may not set you up for the best success. And that's not to freak anyone out. It's just I mean, that's what I found too, because opera is all about opening the voice and full column. I mean, like you are the microphone, you know, but it doesn't work exactly the same because you're right. It's speech level singing. And that's what a mic does well with, right? It doesn't mean that you're not singing full out. No, no, no. I sing full out every single day on Broadway, but it's a different kind of harmonic structure as opposed to this wall of sound in opera coming at you. It's more like this because the mic's going to compress everything anyway, which is why if you hear a full opera singer try to sing Broadway or pop, but not completely alter their technique, something sounds a little amiss, and that's part of it. So let's start again, and I'm going to stop you, okay?
Okay.
And I'm going to give you some more specifics about this.
Okay. I've got my phone in my hand so that I can stop when you say stop.
Perfect. Gonna be soon too. Okay. Let's go. Also for anyone that is doing the song, listening to that bump, bump, that is so key to enter.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to stop you already. So this is what I saw, and I'm going to over-exaggerate, but not too much. These are very popular. That to me sounds like you're ready to make your Met debut. No, but not in a bad way, because again, in the classical world, love, love, love. English singing in opera is so different than music theater English singing. So can you just tell me, since you are just a little bit up above me up there in Boston, can you just say these are very popular for me? And I want you to see, look at yourself in the video and watch your mouth.
These are very popular in Italy.
Can you say it like you're just talking to a friend and not like reciting the song, like the lyrics?
These are very popular in Italy.
Oh, there we go. Now, can you do it again and look at yourself when you did that? Like you're talking to your best friend. These are very popular.
These are very popular.
Okay. Italy. Did you look at your mouth? There's a difference. Did. Before you did what with your mouth when you said popular? Yeah, you said popular. Very nice column. Wonderful. Yes, yes. But when you just were saying it to your friend, what'd you do?
These are very popular.
Yep, that's it. Lur. It's that, but it's also like, notice how like the mouth doesn't, yeah. You are going to open your mouth a little bit more, of course, especially when you are in the passaggio that still counts for music theater, but this is speech level. Can you just, without even me telling technique, can you just watch yourself? Can you say it and then sing it? These are very popular. These are very, I just changed the key, but okay. These are very popular. Sing it. Say it. Sing it.
These are very popular.
Now say it. Sing it.
These are very popular.
I'll take it. I'll take it. That well, already.
I'm closing the end of it. I'm closing the end of it.
A little bit. What you're not doing is over opening the whole thing.
Okay. I can do that.
Now, another something that I went through, it was a journey, is I overcorrected then sometimes. And I got like super like, oh my God, I'm from Chicago. So it's like, these are very popular. Which if you go all the way the other way, that's okay. It's going to be some sweet spot that's just going to take a little time to find out organically what is your voice in just the speaky, right? Mm-hmm. And also another thing, I always approach a music theater score like an opera score, meaning I know if it's a half note, I know if it's a whole note, like what's the cutoff? However, we tend in music theater, not always, but we tend to purposely let things go. So instead of like, if you have, in fact, you know what? Let me get, I have this score. Let me see something real quick. Beauty is. Okay, so these are very popular in Italy. It's the land of naked marble boys. Boys is a dotted, or it, boys is a tied eighth note to a half note. But we're not going to vibrate that bad boy. It's not going to be like an opera where you like, you need that to carry. No. Instead of boy, no. Boys. It's like you're talking. Do this again. And I literally want you to just, I don't care about the singing. We're putting that in quotes, but okay. Speak. Lyric. Just talking to your best friend. Like these naked statues are
really weird.
They're really weird and popular here. Yes, that's it. That's honestly it. It is that simple. Yeah?
Yeah.
Try it. Okay. And cut some of the intro so we can just get straight to the singing.
I can just do it a cappella if you want.
Oh, that's even better. Huzzah. Let's do it, girl.
Okay. Let's talk first.
In fact, if you're comfortable with that, what I would love is say it, one line, sing it. You're going to go back and forth and back and forth and back and forth.
Okay. These are very popular in Italy. It's the land of naked.
Oh, wait, I mean, these are very popular. These are very popular in Italy. In Italy, it's the land of naked marble boys. It's the land of, yeah. Can you do that?
Measure by measure.
Uh-huh.
Measure by measure. These are very popular. These are very popular.
I heard a little opera singer there. Say it again for me.
These are very popular.
Sing it just like that.
These are very popular.
All right, so what I heard, and I'm gonna be like a stickler on this, because this is exactly what I did. And by the way, even on Broadway, we would do this. Like Kristen Blodgett, who's one of my fairy godmothers, she's a music director, she would be like, just say it and sing it. Just say it, that's it. Okay. So you said, these are very popular.
These are very popular.
Okay. So what I'm hearing is, these are very popular. Like, you suddenly got really prim and proper. This girl is, where is she from? Where is Clara from?
She is from Winston-Salem, North
Carolina. Winston-Salem, and she's barely been in Italy. Like, this girl does not say popular at all. No, yeah, these are very popular. You know what? Can you go like this for me? Mm-hmm. Now, here's the other thing, too, for everyone watching. It might feel a little anemic. It might feel a little straitjacketed. It might feel a little squeezed at first. And that's just, like, psychologically what I went through all the time until finally, suddenly, I was like, oh, I can find my space in this little box. Mm-hmm. All right, now don't press your face against it, but just like right here, you get to stay in the box. These are very popular.
Okay. These are very popular in Italy.
Okay, now that definitely felt like, ah, but girl, that's the direction you want to go. Oh, cool. Okay, now can you do it and just kind of loosen it up a little bit? And also, you take your fingers away from your face a little. Yeah, yeah, yeah. These are very popular in Italy.
These are very popular in Italy.
That's it. That's
okay,
it.
All right.
It is. It almost, you know, here's another interesting thing. And like, so my music theater teacher is Matt Farnsworth. He is the creme. Oh, no. Wow. Okay. It goes so fast. And honestly, there's so many times that I'm like, Matt, it feels like I'm not singing. And he's like, yep, that's about right for you because you're singing at about an eighth of what your voice is, like still healthily. So, okay, let's just do, let's skip ahead because I know like these were just like basics, but these kinds of things are going to help you. Can you go to far away from home as someone can go? Far away from home as someone can go. And the beauty is I still meet people I know. It's page, well, in my score, where is it?
It's measured. Before hello.
Yes.
Okay, that one. Okay. Okay. Someone in an old museum. Far away from home is someone.
Good for you. Oh, no, maybe not. I was like, she knows. Oh, we just stopped.
I said the wrong word.
Oh, I was like, you know, I'm going to stop you for that. Never mind. Okay, yeah, well, yeah, yes.
Okay. Far away from home is someone can go.
Okay, now, can you just say far away from someone or far away from home as someone can go?
Far away from home as someone can go.
Far away from home as someone can go.
Far away from home as someone can go.
Sing it.
Far away from home as someone can go.
Good. Now, can you just say go?
Go.
Yep. Actually, that tiny little spot that you just had there, that's the seed, and you're not going to get too much bigger than that. Here's the other thing, too, as an opera singer that always, to me, was a little bit like, me. We don't really get to blossom as much, especially anything higher than a C, and most music theater is not very high, including Christine. Newsflash, it's quite low, actually. And when you have a high note, I would always want to be like, whoa, and they'd be like, no, and you're like, oh gosh, like, so any type of like opening and blossoming, Now, you do have a good idea, which is now in opera, we tend to have like our O's are either a little bit more closed, right? I have found for me personally in the passaggio area, a little bit you're kind of touched on it. And I think you went a little too far instead of someone can go. Go. It almost has a little bit of in it, but not too much. Cause all of a sudden you're like, nah, and you don't want that either. It's an in-between fine line of that. Can you just say far away from home as someone can go? It's that simple. It's going to feel like you're marking.
Okay. Far away from home as someone can go.
Someone can go. And the G here, here's the other thing too. The G's, when we sing g, right? In opera, because we don't have mics usually, we have to make sure those voice consonants also carry. So we tend to anticipate them and make sure that they are very voiced. You got a mic. So actually, if you do that on a mic, it's going to be like, what's happening? So can you just say for me, go?
Go.
Right. Now, I didn't hear go. I heard go.
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 That's it. It will feel like nothing. And when it feels about like it's nothing, you know it's right. It's still fully supported though. This is the other thing too, just for everyone. All of these things I'm telling you, I'll probably say over and over again. Sometimes the other danger is you will unsupport then to try to find that like tiny spot. That's not it either, but it's going to be a journey. Wait, how, Mary, oh my gosh, how are we with time?
We're pretty over.
Yeah, I'm afraid we're probably should move. I will say, I don't see a couple of our singers, so I did give just a little bit extra time, and you probably could just do a couple of extra minutes if you'd like to. So yeah,
sure. Good. Just give me like a 2-3 minute like, oh no, we need to stop, and probably, I'll just keep going with you.
Probably like 3 minutes is where we're at.
Okay, gotcha. Wonderful. Okay, let's talk about Hello.
Yeah.
I hear you, girl. I hear you. So for those watching, also, this is where it's important as an opera singer. What's really cool about us is we really are trained to know our instrument, our vocal apparatus very well. And knowledge is power, until it's not. But knowledge is power when you use it for good. I know that Hello is an E flat, which is right in my passaggio, and goes to a C. Hello. So there's a few things I'm going to do about this, because otherwise it's going to go flat or sharp, because you're either pushing too much air, or you tried to do something funny, not you, the proverbial you, tried to do something interesting to be like, I want that straight tone to the vibrato kind of thing, which absolutely works, but it must be supported or it goes flat. Mm-hmm. So can you back up and sing, and the beauty is I still meet people I know, hello, in the right key?
Yeah.
Wow, that's impressive. Good for you.
and the beauty is I still meet
Nope. Oh, sorry. I gotta stop you. Yes, that's the one. Can you tell everyone what it feels like, the difference between when I was like, you did it the second time.
You liked still?
The second one I liked. The first one I didn't.
Okay. I really kind of let the vowel vibrate through. Like, I tried to give it motion and grow a little bit on that, which is like normally what my instincts are telling me to do when I'm creating a phrase in the opera world, and I can't do that here.
Uh-huh. Right. It's going to feel a little restrictive.
Yeah.
I mean, because what we're going for is that, dare I say, pretty sound,
yeah.
Right? Try it again. And I want you to think about that, because we'll hopefully get to Hello, but I don't know. Let's see how still goes. Again, otherwise it sounds like English art song to me. And I feel like I'm thrown back into Catherine LaBeouf's class, which was amazing, by the way. Still use all of her things, where it's like the safe opiate of the mind. Like, not music, not this role, not Clara. Otherwise, also, here's another interesting thing for you all watching, especially as someone that is much older than a teenager that's been playing teenagers on Broadway for a while. It makes you sound older, especially in the music theater canon. Just FYI.
Yeah.
Okay, let's try it again. And the beauty is.
And the beauty is I still meet people I know.
You do too. And the beauty is I still meet, as if still doesn't matter.
Okay. And the beauty is I still meet people I know.
That's it. Okay. That's it. One more time, and then maybe you get to say hello.
Okay. And the beauty is I still meet people I know. I went.
Nope, and I'm going to stop you now too. Not just that, here's another interesting thing. Now, in American English particularly, beginning and ending consonants, these are absolutely needed, right? We need them. But if you over exaggerate T's, again, in the opera world, we need to make sure those ending T's are quite wet, as we say, right? So that they have distance, and somehow, even though they're not voiced, carry. It's almost like there's a shadow vowel beyond them that's not. Not in music theater though. Otherwise it sounds, again, like you're prim and proper and you're doing it on purpose. I do need all of them, but just scaled back.
Okay.
And again, she's from Salem. Still meet people I know. It's literally still meet people I know.
Okay. And the beauty is I still meet people I know.
That's it.
Hello.
Insane. Okay. That's good. That's great.
Yeah, that didn't feel like very loud at all.
This is the other thing too. So in Phantom, I was singing at, and this is not me bragging, this was just like mind blowing to me. I was singing at about an eighth of my voice and my sound, and they still would just take me and turn me down. Like, so it doesn't matter, but it's going to, it is literally that, that's it. It's that simple. It's that small, but still spacious. Mm-hmm. And just this beautiful little orb that will be carried out to the world with a microphone and not your beautiful instrument without one. How does it feel?
It's just it's a little bit hard to go between, that's all, which, you know, you live there, so it's I know. It's very hard. Yeah, and I definitely feel where I need to dial it back a little bit in terms of bodily movement and everything else. So
exactly.
Yeah,
exactly. Like, I would recommend to everyone, look at yourselves in the mirror. And because a lot of us here are American, you're going to literally sing exactly how you speak, which is kind of wild for me. I mean, my speaking voice is much lower than my actual singing voice.
Yeah.
Same, exactly. But guess what? Most of the music theater canon is also written down that low. So if we start to over open and overdo things like we would in opera, well, we don't over open in opera, but do you know what I mean? Like, what would be considered too open in music theater, it actually is going to take away from that speech. Like, so underdoing consonants, you're gonna dial that way back. The column, gone. It's a different shape, that's all. It's just a different shape. They're all shapes. You're just reconfiguring them so that it's the appropriate. It's, you know what it is, kind of, it's like when you know you're going to an event, you dress appropriately for that event. Unless you want to stand out on purpose. But you know what I mean? Like, if I know I'm going to a rock concert, probably I'm not going to wear a velvet gown. I mean, maybe, I don't know. But I'll wear like spiky boots then with it. So it's still like maybe both. But you know what I mean? Because otherwise it sounds like we're this beautiful opera ball gown in, I don't know, a barn for this one or something. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. Like, I don't know. Do you have any questions? Because how are we on time, Mary? Since we
I think we're out of time. Yeah.
If there's any general questions at the end, if you want to talk a little bit about like vocal care as you're going between styles, that's something I would be really interested in.
Awesome. Please remind me, and 100% yes, because yeah. Well, it's a thing.
Thank you so much. And thank you so much, Mary. I really appreciate it.
Oh yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Maria. Great job. Wonderful. Okay. So I believe Karina, I tried to message you, but I believe that you are here. So if you can plan on going after Katie, who is next. Karina, if you want to message me just so I know that you're planning on it, that would be great. And if Rebecca or Betty are here, if they want to message me as well. I don't think they are, though. So we just might have a little bit extra time for a Q&A or something like that. So, but Katie, if you would please unmute yourself and introduce yourself, that would be great.
Hi, I'm Katie Aumann, and I will be singing Back to Before from Ragtime. And awesome. Apologies in advance for all this going on. I'm in my garage, and I'm located in California.
Awesome.
So, yeah.
All right, let me just pin you so I can see you. Great. All right. Let's give it a go.
Okay. There was a time our happiness seemed never ending. I was so sure that where we were heading was right. Life was a road so certain and straight and unbending. Our little road with never a crossroad in sight. Back in the days when we spoke in civilized voices, women in white and straight. Back in the days when I let you make all my choices, we can never go back to before. There was a time my feet were so solidly planted. You'd sail away while I turned my back to the sea. I was content, a princess asleep and enchanted. If I had dreams, then I let you dream them for me. Back in the days when everything seemed so much clear, women in white who knew their lives were stolen. Where are they now, those women who stared from the mirror? Go back to before. There are people out there unafraid of revealing that they might have a feeling, or they might have been wrong. There are people unafraid to feel sorrow, unafraid of to walk, unafraid to be strong. There was a time that you were the person in motion. I was your wife. It never occurred to want more. You were my sky, my moon, and my stars, and my ocean. To be.
Nice, nice. So I wanted to say, every time you had like a high note, it just cut out sound over to me. I don't know if that happened to anyone else. So it's okay. We'll go to those anyway, because I was like,
okay,
you look like they're going well, but I'm not quite sure if they are.
So actually, really quick, can we try something? Katie, can you go to your sound settings? I think there should be a little tab next to your little mute button. If go to your audio settings and just make sure that the original sound for musicians is clicked.
So, okay. I just changed it because it's at the top. It says original sound for musicians on. Okay.
Yes. Yes.
My bad. Okay.
That will help.
Hopefully that fixes it.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, it's okay. I mean, like, honestly, it was like without fail every time. And I was like, oh no. We were in it. So I was like, we're going to go with the flow. We're going to go with the flow. So we'll touch base. Now, so Katie, tell me, what can I help you with?
I'm working on my mix. Cool. So yeah, that healthy belt mix, and I know like different songs lend themselves to different mixes. Yes. So I know this one is still a little bit more legit, can be sung a little bit more legit. But I still feel like it's, you know, popping out of it in certain places, like especially at the end, when it goes a little bit higher. I played with like doing it fully belting and then doing it more legit, and I like to find a happy medium.
Yeah, well, and you're right, this depending on who sings this song, it can kind of go one way or the other. Yeah. Honestly, it really is performer dependent, but also stylistically, like who has directed it, who's music directing it. So I think it's extremely intelligent of you to be able to honestly give a variety of colors and find the one that you like best that you can present then. Now, out of curiosity, and I don't want to get, I don't want to ever step on anyone's teacher's toes. So anything that I share with you, if it works for you, great. If it doesn't, throw it out. So can you tell me a little bit? So for instance, when you're doing a song like this, working on your mix belt, what are some exercises that you do to prep the larynx, tongue, jaw, and breath apparatus to help you with that? What are some
like
things?
Vocalizations? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, I try on the E vowel something like E, and then go up from there. With my voice teacher for opera, we barely touch musical theater. Like we do, but if there was more time, I wish we, you know, delved deeper into this rep. But you know, so a lot of it is just what I'm kind of experimenting on my own.
Good for you. Honestly, good for you. I mean, I have to say that in general, me sitting at the piano with like the knowledge that I've been given by teachers or coaches, really, this is for everybody. You then need to go and figure that out. I record myself all the time and I'm like, how did that sound? How did that feel? Like, because at the end of the day, you're on the stage without your teachers and coaches. So bravo to you to doing that, because as long as you're not hurting yourself, that this is the way to go. There's going to be a lot of experimentation. And quite frankly, if I say so for myself, from my own experience as well, if you're serious, if anyone is serious about crossing over, I personally think you really do need two teams of people. You really just do, because, and what's awesome is that my teams from the opera world and then my teams from the music theater world, they both very much are like, you should go to the other person because it just, because they're specialists. And like when you're doing this kind of crossover, you need that specialization to know, ah, today I'm going to sing this. So I need to make sure that I've got this very specific puzzle pieces here to play with. And how do they fit with my knowledge from over here then? So I would like to try, if you're game, I have some things for you when I'm using a mixed belt, but mostly mixed. I tend to honestly, well, here's a fun fact also that I was appalled by, but did you know that a lot of belters are actually wonderful coloraturas when you switch us in the other world? Mind blown. It's actually true and crazy. I personally like to mix more than belt, quite frankly, but it's kind of cool when you get to do both. So let me just, I'm not by my piano, but can you hear my little keyboard?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. All right. We're going to make some fabulously ugly sounds. Okay. Again, if anything hurts, we stop.
Mm-hmm.
The first time that Matt did some exercises with me, I was like, I'm sorry, what do you want me to do? Like, I was like, oh, it sounds like it's against everything that I know. So how I warm up for music theater without fail every time is I will start with one of these two vocal warm-ups. And what they're doing is we want to find the edges of your chords. And we purposely want a little bit of vocal fry to find it. That's the scary part, at least it was for me. I was like, what? I was like, vocal fry, oh my God, like, no. But so what we do, and I, you tell me if you can't hear me, but it's like a grumble into like a, and I feel not the up, not way up here, but I feel my diaphragm definitely. Do you feel that?
Uh-huh. Kind of, yeah.
It's
hard to do though.
I know. And again, if it hurts you, do not do it. But strangely enough, this is the thing that saved me constantly. In fact, it's even like a little tool. I mean, this is actually, if you ever hear like Britney Spears, like, actually, if you're super tired, this is a way to kind of activate it. You'd have to make sure you don't use it as a crutch. But I'm going to start you on an A flat below middle C.
Okay.
I want you to do two things for me. Now, obviously, this first thing we're going to do is not something you can do on stage. I'm going to have you breathe through your teeth.
Okay.
And the reason that I want you to breathe through your teeth is because I want you to feel where in your body the breath goes. For me, I'll tell you after, you can tell me where it goes for you. But what it's doing is very similarly to if you are breathing through a straw and you have the breath pressure, there's some kind of friction going on. So I want you to go like this. And then you're going to go, your vocal fry a little bit and go, and your lips are going to be like a vacuum is sucking you forward. Okay. I'm so not warmed up for this today, by the way, but all of this is in chest, by the way.
Okay.
But what we're going to do with this, what we're going to do with this is we are purposely bringing your chest up. Yeah. For me, it's kind of dicey and hairy and uncomfortable, especially when it's my first exercise of the day, okay? It's almost as if I have another passaggio that happens before my regular classical one, and you're like, what happened? And it's so easy as a soprano to want to be like, no way, we'll just do it in head voice. Nope. Yeah. We're going to warm up totally chest at first, okay? And that's going to help with your mix belt, by the way, because what we're doing, FYI, is purposely raising the larynx just a little bit.
Okay.
Yeah. So breathe through your teeth and then.
Okay.
Yeah. Oh, sorry. And it's.
So like on a.
Okay. Yeah. But it goes. And like a little vacuum is going, like sucking your lips forward. Yeah. Good. And also get rid of the vibrato.
Okay.
Oh, and with your teeth, I want like a real nice, like, yeah?
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm kind of hearing. I literally want, like, can you say, yeah, there is no space here. It's completely, this, can you, and keep your lips closed? So it's like this. I'm going to get nice and close, guys. So there's no hole. That's it, girl. That's it. And for me, it feels like the air goes kind of in like behind the nose and comes back down like this. Yeah?
Yeah.
So up, we're going to go up a half step now. And by the way, this is the tempo we'll do. Breathe through your teeth, feel it in your back, feel it here, and then go ahead. And I want that, like you're starting an engine. Good. No vibrato.
Okay.
Good, good. And if you can you make it more legato and not so placed now? Yeah. Good, good. It's going to get a little dicey. We do it again, and I'll tell you why. So this is, we're only going to do two more, okay? But right now, just to let you know, we're on a middle C. For me, this is when it starts to feel like, I want to start doing opera-y things. And the answer is no. So instead of, we're going to want to create space. To me, it almost feels like at any moment it could go like that. It's a little uncomfortable, but it's going to help you later.
Okay.
There you go. One more. Breathe your teeth. Good. Down. Keep it simple. It's
Oh, going down.
Good. Now we're gonna start on an A flat, and I want you. Oh, we're gonna try a couple different things. Mine. We're gonna try mine, like mine. It's mine. And we're gonna do. We're gonna try nay. And this is what I want. Nay. I mean, and I don't want nay. Nope. Nay. And if it's pitchy, I don't care. At this point, what we want to do again is we want to get kind of in a space and like a space.
Okay.
Nay.
Nay.
And I want between the fourth and the fifth note, purposely, I want you to do a little scoop.
Nay.
But you make it sound so pretty at the top. I don't need the nay. And this is an A flat also. So FYI, in general, when I'm warming up for like a mixy kind of sound, not Glinda. Glinda's her own weird little thing, P.S. I will usually start as a soprano, as a coloratura, a G or an F sharp under middle C is where I'll start, which is pretty low because usually I'll never sing that low in the music theater canon, but it's warming up down there, which is good for when we're getting in the middle voice. I've found myself, okay? So this is an A flat. Mine. Right, this is another thing where we're carrying chest up. Whenever I sing music theater, I always warm up my chest voice first. And I actually almost barely touch my head voice, quite frankly. So mine. It's a little low, but that's okay.
Mine.
This is something that I tend to do too. And I'm from Chicago, so I naturally have like a I need a little more chest. Here's something that I did and that a lot of us tend to do when we're kind of overcompensating, doing this like, I'm going to sound kind of like a munchkin now. I need a little bit more chest as opposed to mine. Do you hear the difference?
Yeah. Mine.
Ah, good. Now, can we... I'll move it up a little bit. Mine. And you know what? Actually, instead of the whole arpeggio for now, mine. Let's just do 1-3-5-3-1.
Okay.
We'll go the whole octave, okay? Mine. Instead of mine.
Yeah.
Mine. I'll take it. Sorry.
Mine.
Take it. Now, let's go back underneath. By the way, if you need a sip of water, take one.
Oh,
okay. Back to the A flat. Now, this is the trombone exercise. This helps regulate breath. And what it also does is it makes sure that you're not over pushing air. And it, again, has to do with breath resistance. I can't do it in the middle of my mouth. I can only do it on the left side. So on the left it is. It's going to look like this. It's like, have you ever tried out for band or anything, anyone, and you had to like try to play the trumpet? I mean, I did not make it in there because I couldn't do it, but it's like this. So this is totally closed. And here I've got a little bitty opening. Right. So do you feel air coming out only like either in the middle or the side?
Yeah.
All right. So by the way, when I would do Christine on Broadway, I would do this all the time, all the way up to a high C, because it's teeny. And so this really helps with the mix, because we want to make sure we're not overblowing air in that middle part when you're mixing. Okay. So,
okay.
And you're going to go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 3, 5, 8, 5, 3, 1. Okay. So. Sorry, go ahead.
Okay. On just like.
Yeah, so it's gonna sound like this.
You're cutting out a little bit, but yeah. I think I got it.
You guys hear me? It's.
Okay.
Now, good first go. Now I hear a little bit of. I'm like totally over. Great, baby. Again, we want this, like, especially for mixy belt, it's this stretch. It's this stretch that's happening. If we let it relax in any way, and I don't mean tense, like bad tense, it's a good tense. If there's any type of relaxation, which is exactly what we're taught to do in opera, right? Like, let those babies go.
Yeah.
It's opposite. It's so much more structured, and it's more of like a taffy feeling as opposed to a this feeling.
Right. So,
instead of I'll take it. Let's go up. Oh, sorry. A. Good. And I don't care if the arpeggio's in tune or not. So you're just going to go through that up like flip. So it's going to go this. And if you go, okay. Whatever, I don't care. Good. Can you have a little bit more pressure? Let's go up. And by the way, when I'm doing this, my diaphragm definitely feels like she's going, I call her she. She's going like this. Because otherwise, if it's unsupported, it kind of gets breathy. And then I'll... Yeah.
It can be, yeah.
Yeah, it's going to be so much less air than you think.
Yeah.
Good. And calm the body and plant it so that the air and everything can do it, as opposed to the head or the neck. And don't get me wrong, I love this moment. I constantly do it. And I'm very locomotive, which actually to me, like, to center myself takes a lot. So yeah. Okay, good. I know we don't have a lot of time left, but can you start the song again?
Yeah.
And what I want you to do this time is, can you go, let's use meow, like cat. Every word is meow.
Okay, and do you want me to start from the beginning, or?
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, or you know what, go to a spot that I know, like probably one of those high notes that I couldn't hear. Go maybe somewhere. Okay.
I can take it from the
side. Wherever is good.
I'll do it a cappella, that way it's, how about second verse? There was a time. Okay.
And meow. We're going to try meow, or we're going to try nay, or we're going to try meow. Anything that's like that kind of hook is really good for music theater.
Uh-huh. Okay. I can go even actually farther to the end then maybe.
Since we don't have a lot of time, wherever you would like. Because you're going to meow it at us anyway.
I'll do it from there. I'm just going to find my pitch really quick. I'm getting my piano. There are people. Okay. Oh. Meow, 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 meow. Meow. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Aha. Too pretty of a meow.
Yeah.
Meow, 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 meow. Now. Oh. Nay, 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 nay. Nigh, nigh, nigh. Try nigh. Nigh, 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 nigh. I'm not warmed up to do any type of this, okay?
Okay.
It's going to sound more like that. And not a lot, like, very conservative with your breath. I'll take it. Not bad. Yeah, keep going. Keep going.
9999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999
1 1 1 1 1 1. That one may be hard on the top note, but try it.
1 1 1 1 1 1.
But can you go 1 1 as opposed to 1 1 1 1 1 1? To me, yeah, that's a little too opera-y. 1 1 1 1 1 1, like you're saying one to your friend in Trader Joe's.
1 1 1 1 1 1.
Okay, let's drop one. No ones. We'll try the nays and the nays and the meows. I think, okay, are going to be your choice. Yes, yes.
Okay.
So, can you do one phrase, 9 9 9 9 9 9, and then can you sing it with the words?
Yeah. Uh huh. 9 9 9 9 9 9.
Sing.
There are people out there.
It's closer to this, and I know the jump, uh-huh, is not what we want at this moment,
mm-hmm,
but this is more the area and, like, the path. That's where, uh-huh, you want to go.
Uh-huh.
That, okay, is, like we did with Maria, that is actually, mm-hmm, far more speech level.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Another thing you can do to help navigate those... Oh, wait, are we way over time? Mary, yeah. Oh, no. We're at zero. Oh, no! Okay. But these kind of things are warm up, yeah, your low voice, bring the chest up.
Okay.
Anything that's mine, 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 nay, 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 nay is a good one. Or 1 1 1 1 1 1 1 nay, nay, meow. They all have that hook in it kind of a thing. And that is so helpful because that's going to help you when you stretch for the mixed belt down here.
Mm-hmm.
I know we didn't get to, but we had to do this other stuff because just to, like, even get there, you need to make, yeah, sure that everything's kind of ready to go. Otherwise, no. But try that. And also, one more thing. With this song in particular, I would recommend to you that you really take this and break it apart as a monologue.
Uh-huh.
And everything, because it is strophic. And unless there are extreme presence and discoveries in each of these things that she's reliving or discovering, yeah, for the first time, it kind of just becomes a wash of a pretty sound.
Okay.
And unfortunately, there's no such thing as just a pretty sound in music theater. People will, mm-hmm, be like, bye. Like, yeah, they want to know what's coming next. So I would also say to you, on an acting standpoint, really just look at this text and, first of all, make it as personal as possible, but treat it as a monologue.
Uh-huh.
And here's, like, a kind of a cop-out, but I use it sometimes. You can literally think, what else? Or what's next? And just that, because that is what the character would think, right? She doesn't know what she's going to say. You know what she's going to say, but she doesn't know what she's going to say. So, like, huh. Oh, right. Oh, you know what I mean?
Right. Yeah.
That could be a helpful tool to you as well until you really start, like, getting it into your own. And then you'll forget about the singing. And then it'll just go. It's wild how it works, but yeah.
Awesome. Thank you.
Thanks, Katie. That's
really helpful.
Yeah. Okay. Bye.
Thanks, Katie. That was great. Okay. I think our last singer today will be Karina. So Karina, can you unmute yourself and introduce yourself to Meghan?
Yes, of course. Hello.
Hello.
I'm living in Florida, but I'm from Argentina.
Ah, very nice.
And my parents are Italian, so I speak Italian. And I have, I think, the opposite thing. It's like hard to me sing and speak in English because okay. I have open, like I have to do the opposite, I think.
Okay.
And my thing is the same, the girl said. I'm trying to do the belting sound. And when I warm up, I make like the witch. I say the witch, nya, 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 that kind of things. But sometimes sounds to me like a scream, you know, like something This is a lot. When I'm trying, we say cover when we like. I try to not to cover, and sometimes like it's loudy or something. I think we have the opera singers. We have like the our judgment about our like we are afraid to do something wrong or not beauty sounds. You understand me?
Oh, I get you.
Okay.
100%. I see you and feel you. And yes, I think that is sadly ingrained to us a lot from conservatory, where, you know, nothing's ever perfect.
Yes.
Or it's blah, blah, blah. Like, luckily in the music theater world, I mean, yes, there is technique, but you let it go. And actually, that's something I'm trying to bring back over into the opera world. Like that PTSD of like, it must be perfect. It's not going to be perfect, probably, honestly, almost ever. But, like, perfection is not what we're actually striving for, especially in music theater. I mean, I know people will want to fight me on that statement. But, like, it's actually communicating the human condition to one another. It's just in a different form, especially when it's music theater, right? I mean, but even opera, it has to be soul to soul, because even if someone has the most beautiful voice, I mean, sure, there are the occasions that break that rule and you're like, wow. But like at the end of the day, it's about being a vessel for whichever, whether it's Puccini or Andrew Lloyd Webber, it's a vessel for that music and that story and sharing it with everyone else that's there. At least that's what I personally very much strongly feel. So, and the more that we, don't get me wrong, we need to be good cops for ourselves, right?
Yeah.
But we harp on each other or harp on ourselves and we want the perfect pitch right away. Actually, if we let go and fall on our faces a lot, we're probably going to discover our true voice, one, and two, a varieties of beautiful colors that we would otherwise have been scared to even look at or try because it's not perfect.
Yeah. And sometimes what happened to me in my personal experience was like, oh, you sound like Disney, or you sound like lyric. You can do differently, because sometimes happened to me, like I sound like two different people. You know, so this song, the unexpected song, was like, I have a psychological problem with this song, because I sang this song in audition in the musical theater school, and the director told me, oh no, it was terrible, because has the high notes, like I heard Bernadette Peters in different like performances, and she always sound differently, sometimes more classic and sometimes more belting, you know. But I have two different songs, Unexpected Song and Ragtime, Your Daddy's Hands. So I don't know.
Whatever you would like to do is what I think you can give.
Okay. Unexpected Song, because it's more difficult. Okay.
Okay.
Let me know if you. I've never felt like this. For once I'm lost for words. Your smile has really thrown me. This is not like me at all. I never thought I'd know the kind of love you showed me. Now, no matter where I am, no matter what I do, I see your face appearing like an unexpected unexpected song, an unexpected song that only we are hearing. I don't know what's going on, can't work it out at all, wherever made you choose me. I can't just believe my eyes, you look at me and oh, you couldn't bear to lose me. Now, no matter where I am, no matter what I do, I see your face appearing like an unexpected song, an unexpected song. There only we are hearing. I have never felt like this. For once, I'm lost for words. Your smile has really thrown me. This is not like me at all. I never thought I'd know the kind of love you show me. Now, no matter where I am, that's the theme. Hello, are you there?
Uh-oh, did we lose Meghan? Shoot, hopefully she'll come back in just a second. Let's see. Oh, there she is.
Okay.
Are you there, Meghan? Maybe, Meghan? Oh, Karina, it was sounding, okay. Oh, she's back. Hold on.
Okay.
Here she comes. Meghan, are you back? Oh, no. Let's see. I don't know. Meghan, if you can hear me, I'm going to try to remove you. Oh, wait, there. Are you there? Well, shoot. I thought so. Okay. I'm going to try to remove her. We don't want to do that. Well, oh, I know she's really sad. We'll give her one more minute, see if we can get her back. If you guys have any questions for Meghan, you guys can be thinking of those and you can add them to the chat. We'll probably have maybe just like 10 minutes possibly to ask questions, but okay. If she is able to rejoin us, that is, I'm so sad. Oh, maybe this is her. Maybe this will work. Meghan, are you there?
There, I heard everything. I heard everything. I just was like, oh no, everyone's freezing, but hang on, I'm on my iPad now. Okay, no, I heard everything. Karina, you have a beautiful voice. Beautiful voice.
Thank you.
Okay, I want to help you. I have some thoughts for you, and I think I can help you.
At this point, then, I can't do that with this voice. I think like no matter what I am. So, like, I need to do that because...
So here's the thing. I love that you've done your homework and that you have Bernadette Peters. Oh, you know, love, like amazing, right? That being said, it's time to let Bernadette Peters go and let Karina come in and do her version of this song. So this is the thing. I love listening to people of times past that have done roles that are legends, right? And then I stop listening to them because the thing is, then it's time for me to avatar with that role. And everyone's instrument is totally different. Even if it's similar, there's something different. And we have to become one with it in our own beautiful way. So the way that she's done it, and the cool thing about an artist that understands their voice and their instrument, that's why sometimes she's like, you know what? I think today we'll belt. Maybe she's sick. Maybe she's tired. And she's like, actually today I'm not going to do that. Or maybe she's just feeling a different emotion. And that's actually what I'm talking about, is once we start being able to paint with many different colors, we can choose depending on either how we're feeling, whether it's health or not, or just like the vibe we're feeling or the audience we're singing for, right? Like if I'm going to sing to a way more classical audience, I might pump up the classical side of my voice just a little bit more than if I were singing for like 54 below, right? It's kind of knowing your audience. Let me pin you so you're big. Great. Okay. So, I think this is great in your voice, actually. But I do think what we can help you with is navigating, because this song is also like, you chose a nice and tough song, which is, I like it. I like the courage. Get it. Is making sure that you're indeed, whether it's low or high or middle voice, is still actually the same voice. And this is actually where opera and music theater, I personally think, are very much on the same page. Like, it is your voice, whether you're high, middle, or low. Now, what shade of your voice or what color of your voice will depend, right? So something that can help you with this is actually what I just did before. And it's that trombone lesson. Or if you happen to have a straw and you can blow bubbles in water. Do you have a straw, actually? I know it's random, but do you have one with you?
No.
Okay. No. Here's something you can do, is you can take the straw and you're going to blow bubbles into the water, right? And you're going to blow on the actual pitch. So, and what that's going to do is it's going to create that water. Obviously, is harder for the breath to go through than just air. It's going to, your body has no choice but to regulate it, okay? And because of that, you're going to get a pretty even sounding voice, top to bottom, because you either will do it or nothing will happen. Like, it's one of those things. So here's what we can do. Because I have a feeling you have a pretty sizable instrument, probably, if you were to like let loose, which is awesome. It does mean, how do we also translate then into a smaller sound without completely, like, this is something that I really had to deal with as young Christine, is like, how do I thin my voice but still have true Meghan voice and not like, I tried to just be this. Like, cause that's not me either. Like, can we start it again? And I'm gonna stop you. So watch and hear, get ready, okay?
Okay, yes, of course.
I have never felt like this.
Okay, I'm also going to help you with this. Okay, good, good, good.
Yeah.
Part of it too, now you have the wonderful privilege of speaking many languages, which is awesome. I wish that that were most of us Americans, but it's not. Something that might also be helpful to you, instead of us even just talking technique, and tell me if this is okay for you, otherwise we can try other things, is the diction itself actually will hinder or help you. Something that is quintessentially American English is our use of diphthongs, which is two vowels together, right?
I la di da da da.
Can you tell me the words? I don't know the words.
I have never felt like this.
Okay. Can you say this super? So this is when I'm singing in German or French, something that is not my mother tongue. This is what I do. You're going to say it a couple different ways. One, I would like you to say, and by the way, is this work okay with you?
Yes, of course.
Diction work?
Yes.
Awesome. Awesome. Because sometimes it's just the vowel or placement of a tongue to say L that changes everything. It's amazing. So what I would like you to say really slow is I yep,
have
never I want you to really
never
like you're spitting everywhere, felt And for the L, is totally American, right? So, fa, can you say fa? No L yet. Fa.
Fa. Fa. Fa. Felt.
Yeah. Felt. Like you're going. Yeah.
Felt.
So, now, have you ever seen the movie? This is a pop reference, but maybe you have. Have you ever seen Finding Nemo?
No.
I don't think so. Okay, there is a character, Dory, who, like, she's a fish that speaks whale, and she's like,
Yeah.
Okay, this is the next thing we get to do, which is to make that legato, and it's going to sound like this. It's going to sound,
okay.
I have that. It's almost as if you are a child that is discovering words for the first time. And I do this with all, even English, I do this with, because basically what this is going to do is it's going to start training the tongue and the mouth. Because again, you're so lucky, you speak so many different languages. Americans, we barely move our top lip, first of all, like almost nothing is happening here. Mm-hmm. Meanwhile, if you speak Spanish or Italian, it's like, right? Like there's so much going on. It's amazing. But even that is such a difference than when you try to sing music theater, because if that knowledge isn't in these muscles, it's already, there's another step that's happening that's going to work against you instead of for you. So we want to change it so it works for you. So now, again, only if you're comfortable, we're going to say it like we're Dory. And it's, I want you to explore in your mouth and your throat and your tongue and your lips. What does every sound for I have never felt this way before sound like?
Okay.
I feel like. Okay.
Okay.
Here we go.
So I have never.
So here's another thing. Yeah. is essentially American.
Yeah, I know.
I have never.
Never. Felt like this.
Okay, now, can you, for now, can you take your tongue for, so when I'm singing in Italian, I have to make sure that certain voiced consonants are more dental, right? Like T's, and, but for American, no. And a voiced TH, can you take your tongue and just for now, can you really vibrate it between your teeth? So I'm hearing a little more of a Z. Can you hear it? Can you take your tongue actually and go like this for, if you're okay with it, can you go like this for me? Yeah, that's more of the sound. Now, obviously you're not going to, when you actually sing it, you're not going to go, I've never been in the land before, right? You're not going to do that. But as you are discovering how to translate your musculature knowledge of all those other languages and how to transform them into and translate them into an English mouth, an English American mouth, this is what you're gonna do. You're really gonna do a lot of like, interesting. Because those positions that as an American, we naturally have a tendency to line up with because that's what we're talking every day, is an extra step that you're going to do as someone where English is your fourth language, third language, right? You're like, it's eighth language, right? This is going to help you. You're going to be doing a lot of speaking, a lot of speaking. So can you for me now say, I
have
never
felt
good.
Felt
this
way
before. Good. Awesome. Now, can you sing it for me?
Yes. It's
just that. That's it. If you haven't noticed, everyone, working in teeny tiny chunks is the best way.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Remember, you just said it.
I have never felt like this.
Hey, no, you know what? Look, it's great. You know what? This is great. No, also, I love the laughter because that's exactly what it's going to feel like at first, okay? Like, honestly, if you're going to go overboard and be like, wow, I feel so odd. What just happened?
I feel like right. Sofia Vergara, you know?
No, it's great. And by the way, I didn't say this earlier, but everyone that's doing this in front of everyone else, the courage it takes, it's amazing. And I applaud all of you. Good. Now, overdo it one more time. And then just really, we're going to simplify. Okay.
Okay. I have never felt like this.
Oh, did I make up before? Was that not part of it? Sorry. All right. So now can you just, as if you're talking to a baby, singing to a baby. Okay. I have never felt like this. Like okay. Right here. She's right here and you don't want to wake her up. You're not okay. Going to whisper, but she's right here.
Okay. I have never felt like this.
Better. Yes. Mm-hmm. Can we keep going?
Yes. I have never felt like this. For once I'm lost for words. Your smile has really thrown me.
Better. Now, okay. When you do these, right? They kind of go lower. This is where you can also use that trombone thing I did with Katie. Mm-hmm. And purposely, I want you to, which again, you're not going to do in real life. I purposely want you to go, as it's going to feel like you're waterfalling down the front of the face. Try it. Try it again. That's it. That's it. And what are the words?
Thrown me.
Thrown me. Can you go? Thrown me. Thrown me.
Thrown me.
But don't open. Keep it right where that little like was.
Thrown me.
That's it. That's it. That's the one. Teeny. I have to tell you, as an opera singer, everything in the music theater world feels like it's the size of a flea. It's so tiny. And your voice is stunning, by the way. That's all you need. It is that small. Get supported. Try it again. Thrown me. It's that. That's it.
Okay.
Try.
From the top?
Just thrown me again.
Okay. Thrown me.
Keep going. And what I would like you to do is, I would do whatever the notes are and then say that same thing with with the word.
Thrown me.
Yeah. Keep going.
This is not like me at all.
Okay, now, this is what I want. Now sing right there.
This is
not too big.
This is not like me at all.
Can you go? Keep going just on that. Breathe. Keep going on that. Okay, now here's one more thing for you. So that. What you're going to do here is purposely scoop up and down, because what I want you to feel eventually, and it may not happen right away, okay, is I want you to actually, you will eventually, and I promise it will happen eventually, you're going to feel a stretch. Now, for us, when we say stretch, we kind of think it's like this, but really think about the chords are like, it's going to be like this. It's nothing, but it's going to feel like this. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But it always comes back to this like, can you try it for me? Yeah. You know what? When you go down, think up. Think opposite.
Okay.
Yeah. That's it. Mm-hmm. Because if we overthink we're going up and down, we'll overcorrect with the brain. Right? Mm-hmm. And we'll go, as opposed to like, so think opposite. And also their neighbors, they're right here. Oh, 0 minutes. Okay, really quickly. Try.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. That's it. That's it. Can you just sing it right there? Right there in that space.
No, no matter what I am.
Yes. Now, eventually, once you get comfortable with what it feels like inside, you will be able to open your mouth a little bit, but not too much.
Okay.
Right now, it's going to feel very like, right now. But by the way, that is the space of the song.
Okay. It is so a smile can help, a little smile.
Yes, it can. It can. Mm-hmm. It can, because it lifts the soft palate a little bit, right? But regardless, it's everything is in that tiny spot. And that's all you have to do. In fact, anything more, and it starts to sound like, what is she singing? Is that music theater or something else? But it's teeny and it's gorgeous. You have a stunning voice, by the way.
Thank you.
It just stays right in that tiny little like.
And the high notes, the same?
Yep. So wait, go. I know we're over time, but for instance, I'm doing the same thing. Like my high notes for Kunigunda or Queen of the Night, they're all right there. In that.
Okay.
You're like, I'm not sure if I trust you on this one, but maybe.
I trust it, but it's difficult. It's not easy.
I know we're done, but go to like a high note for me and like a couple notes before. And I want, it's by the way, it's going to feel uncomfortable at first.
Okay. Let me be sure, is the note the right note here? No matter where I am, no matter what I do.
It's already better. It's already better.
I'm trying.
Because it's more connected and it's closer together instead of no, which I'm totally like, I'm over exaggerating, right? But now it's here. No, not it at all. It's right here instead of makes you do it. You have no choice. Otherwise, it goes. Bleh. So because of that, then you just have to feel it, and then that's where you're gonna sing it. Yeah.
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you, Karina. Thank you. Okay.
Oh, wonderful. Thank you, Karina.
Thank you.
So, Meghan, we basically are kind of out of time, but
a couple questions if people want to stick around.
There are a couple of people have posted in the chat questions. So if you have a question, maybe you can, or if you put down it in the chat, maybe you can just unmute really quick or raise your hand and we'll get you. Would that work?
Question.
There we go.
Yes, Meghan, I really appreciate everything you've been saying tonight. I have a big question. I'm going to be music directing Bright Star. And now we're talking about the Appalachian Carolina accent and working with a cast. How do you warm these people up with that kind of dialect and not hurt them?
Okay. So to be really honest with you, at least from, again, I'm always talking from my own personal experience.
Oh, sure.
I don't warm up my voice for a particular accent, quite frankly. I do warm up a style, but I do not warm up my voice if I'm singing with a mid-Atlantic or with a Cockney or with a, you know what I mean? I don't warm up for accents. I'm gonna treat it as, okay, we're doing Bright Star. I wanna make sure that I'm speaking or I'm singing in my speaky voice.
Right. Right.
So a lot of the exercises I did. Yeah. Oh, sorry.
I want to warm them up so that they're not sounding like an opera chorus, but, you know, so that they sound like they're at a barn dance.
Yes. Okay. So a lot of the exercises I did with Katie, these are things I do like kind of all the time. Another thing you can do for group, let me think. Okay. Well, that one can get opera-y if you're not careful, but this is something I definitely do is re, re, la, la, mi, re, re, la, la, mi. That's one of them. And you'll just keep going up, no higher than like a C. Some other ones you can do are the mine, 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 mine. Yes. Yes. One is a good one. One, 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 or one, 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 one. Arpeggios are great. Some other ones that I do. Oh, of course. And I didn't do that with anyone. The lip trills.
Yep.
But there are two ways of doing lip trills. There is the opera way, and then there's the music theater way, which I didn't even know was possible, but it's true. So okay. Opera way is much more like, it's very just like, oh, yay. And then music theater is chest heavy until it can't be. And it's pretty evident when it can't be. And then it will like naturally go, but like lip trills, humming, like we do with Katie, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Oh God, there's so many beautiful ones. There's also anything ni ne na, like what we okay. also do with Katie. Any like those are good things that will keep the vowels a little bit more spread as opposed to round and velvety.
That's what I'm aiming toward. It's not so much the dialect, but it's the spread.
Uh-huh. Yeah. So that's a good one I use when I really need to get in there. Yeah. So anything like that, as opposed to like round or oval.
Sure.
Yeah.
Sure. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Have a great show.
I hope.
Okay. So Yoshiko had a question. They said, I have a question for Meghan. Your cadenza is beautiful, especially the one from Cadenza contest on Sir Andrew's Facebook. Oh, and I wonder how you sing that long of a note with one breath. You have any tips for holding out the long notes?
Yeah, planning is key. So when I know something's coming, you have to make sure that you take the right kind of breath before you go for it. It's a blueprint. Like my knowing when to breathe is just as important as the actual singing itself. Because if you have a long note coming up, you also need to know how to pace yourself before that long note comes up. Otherwise, by the time it happens, you'll be out of gas and it'll just kind of be like, or there's little tricks of the trade. Like, I mean, when you do it every day, sometimes you just don't feel good. And so you'll take what the audience probably can't hear, but you'll take like a little catch breath, but that it's a quick tank up catch breath. It's like a, it's like you kind of inflate like a little balloon, like very quickly, and then you go for it. Or you do the diva thing, which I did do sometimes, which is like, you make them wait for it because you're taking a breath, but you make them wait for it. But everything about your intention is fully engaged, where like, they're just like, yes. And it's absolutely part of the scene for you to be able to do that, which is great. Everything waits for you. So like, for instance, if you're talking about like the end of Think of Me, of me, like that, at right, the high C, you just make sure like you're fully well prepared, and then you go, and you're literally told the thought behind it is, I am the diva of me. So that's how it's planning. It's planned breath. Absolutely. And especially in Think of Me, when you're running around in point shoes with a skirt that weighs 35 pounds on your bum, and then like a scarf, by the time you get to the end of that song, you're like, what? So you really need to take a second and like re-catch your breath. Because if you don't, it's not going to happen. So.
Oh, I love that. That is awesome. Okay. I think we have time for one more. Maria, if you want to go ahead and ask your question, that'd be great.
Yeah, Meghan, hi, thank you. It's not again, it's not always avoidable, especially when you're in the earlier stages of your career, that you have to go in between styles a lot, even when you're not like, I'm not a fully seasoned musical theater singer at all yet, but yet kind of obligated to go between the two sometimes. How do you deal with exhaustion when you're going between the two styles, and like, how do you care for your voice during that time?
Right. Okay. So this is important because if you, again, this is my experience. Okay. I personally think if you can do both, kind of like speaking more than one language, at first you might be a little bit behind, but then all of a sudden when things come to a head, you're able to speak two languages and everyone else is only able to speak one. So it might be frustrating at first because both might be on like a slower pace because you're learning both, which actually for me, learning more of one at one time and then transferring over was a little bit easier. But now that I am doing both, it really is like slow and steady, and it's a little bit slower progress because you're constantly like comparing the two. And indeed, if you switch back and forth too much, and I mean like the same day, you might even hurt yourself because the larynx position is indeed different for music theater than it is for opera. Now, that doesn't mean that you can't sing some of, depending on, it's like a Venn diagram, right? Now, if you're singing Tosca and then all of a sudden you want to sing like popular, like, sure, you might be able to do it, but like, how many times until you hurt yourself? Probably not too many, honestly. So I would say to you is be intelligent about when you have a rep list of what you're going to do for the day, like, group them if you can, if it's possible. And if it's not, for some reason, do the classical stuff first, rest, rewarm up the body in music theater, and then do the music theater stuff. I have also found, like, for instance, like I've been doing a lot of concert lately, and Glitter and Begay is always on there because that's like my signature, right? She's got to go last. And I insist upon it because if I do that and then I try to do anything else in the music theater canon, because I popped up to my high F there, okay, but like I've just completely restructured my larynx for nothing like the rest of the program. So it's also about that too, is when you sing stuff. So can you tell me out of curiosity, like what's some of your rep? Give me like three music theater songs and three opera songs that you're working on, or classical pieces that you're working on.
Oh my gosh. I mean, right now I'm kind of keeping it all kind of legit out of safety, because I am still kind of learning what I'm doing. I would say right now I'm going between like some, I think the thing that I do that's like the most belty is maybe like some Waitress or even some like folk songs, like some Joni Mitchell kind of stuff where like I can
okay. Pop up
there and it feels okay, but I can still belt if I want to. And for opera, I'm getting hired to do a lot of Minotti. So I'm kind of living in that in between space.
No. Look, this like, is great. Look, here's the thing. No. But actually that like worries me less than if you were to be like, I'm starting Verdi.
No, I'm like Anna Etta Ina Minotti stuff all the way.
This is great.
Thing I'm doing is like maybe some Wolf art song.
Yeah. Honestly, oh Wolf, it's been a moment. honestly, this is actually great. You're in a good Venn diagram then, because you haven't gone too far either way. The days that you want to sing more of your folk, which by the way, like actually, I myself have also been experimenting a little bit with like, like. Can I sing a little bit more like of a blues? What does it feel like? What does it sound like? Also, I'm not going to be singing Serenata that day though. Okay. Like must choose. Like, but your Venn diagram is a good one. Minotti and like the Inas are not super heavy opera, right? But yeah. Do know again, like, but if you're going to sing Joni Mitchell, maybe that's the day that you maybe do music theater in Joni Mitchell, because that Venn diagram is a little bit over here, especially like as you're figuring things out and your instrument. The more you go like this, the more like everything is going to go like that. Mm-hmm. Right. So I would say if you can, if you do have the luxury of time, is try to stay a little bit closer in styles each day, even. Okay. So like one day you're going to say the beauty is, and I could have danced all night and think of me. The next day, depending how your voice feels. Okay. So today I'm going to do, Monica's waltz and, Una Donna. Do you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Divide them up a little bit.
Yeah.
And then what you can do is experiment in a way of be like, so when I sing Monica, what does that feel like compared to when I'm singing Clara and the beauty is? What am I feeling that's different inside of me? Because I think something that at least I was perhaps robbed of, not Rob, Rob seems very aggressive, but something that I realized is we have a lot more power and knowledge than I think a lot of us are told or given. And we really do, actually.
Yeah.
Of course, teachers and coaches are amazing. Like they're showing us signposts and technique, but at the same time too, like I've said before, even in this class, our instrument is very personal. And as long as you're not hurting yourself, I mean, if you feel pain, stop. If you feel very sore, stop. Just like you went to the gym, right? Like if you're like, wow, I'm limping. Let's not run on that tomorrow, okay? But also experiment. This is, you know, when I went to grad school, no one knew I was a coloratura. It wasn't until I was like, I wonder if I can sing high. And then I was like, wait, I could totally sing high. Ha ha. So like, this is what I'm saying. Like, experiment a little bit. And also like, record yourself. Because here's the other thing too. We are so used to listening to so many other people. Listen to yourself. I bet you, you will be so much of a great teacher to yourself than you even know. You're going to listen and be like, oh, that's out of tune. How could I make that in tune? Oh, that vowel, I feel like it sounds a little like an SNL skit. Sounds like it's funny instead of like true to what it be. What would I do to change that? What if I brighten the vowel? What if I darken the vowel? So do a lot of that on your own too, because honestly, you're going to suddenly be like, and you're going to empower yourself and trust yourself a lot more. And going into an audition with that kind of knowledge and that kind of confidence is everything, girl. It's everything. Because you're like, you may think that you want me to color it like this, but I have chosen to color it like this. You know what I mean?
Yeah, so, thank you so much. It's really, it's a very helpful. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Meghan. Oh, I loved that advice, man. Trust yourself, right? And learn from yourself. I love that. So thank you so much, everyone, for being here. This has been so fantastic. And Meghan, as always, I've loved working with you. You're just a joy. And it's been so great to have you with us. We are doing another masterclass next month with a performance psychologist who's going to talk about a little bit about stage fright and things like that. So, and mental health. So I think that's going to be really great. Hope you guys can meet us then. And thank you, everyone, and have a good night.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Bye.
Bye. Thank you. Thank you.